Hi there, Lindsay here, the Frugal Crafter. Today we're going to paint a landscape in acrylics. This is a nice bright painting, and we're going to start off with a nice bright medium yellow, and we're going to kind of trace the top of a mountain range here, and we're going to start putting in some of the sky color. So I'm envisioning the sun setting behind this mountain, and that's why we have that yellow blotch up there. I'm also sketching in a path that's going to be water, and I'm just doing that right with the yellow because I have it on my brush already, and it will just kind of blend in and disappear as I paint over top. I'm adding a little bit of yellow ochre into the sky there to warm it up a little bit, get that nice golden sunrise going. And while I go, I try to paint the edges of my canvas too. That way, if I decide I don't want to frame it, it can be hung up and then the edges look nice. I'm adding a little bit of white into my sky color there, so it'll be nice and opaque and easy to blend. And I'm also adding in a little bit of magenta into the yellow to make kind of an orange. And then I'm working that into pink. So I'm just trying to blend my colors together and not create mud. So we've got the yellow going into orange, going into kind of a magenta pink, and hitting our edges as we go. So now I'm going to go into more of a brighter pink, and the brush I'm using is it's an oval wash or filbert, whichever you want to call it. This one is by the Menta All Media line. It's a golden tack-on brush. The nice thing about a filbert or an oval wash is that you've got the stiffness of a flat brush, so it's easy to push around that acrylic paint, which tends to be a little bit thicker, but you also have that rounded edge, so you don't end up with those harsh brush strokes when you're trying to blend. So I've gone into, from the magenta, I've gone into a little bit of purple, and I'm just working on blending those out. I'm also going to pull in a little bit of a cobalt blue here at the edge, and my goal is to kind of get this really nice gradiated bright sunrise sky going. I've picked up a little bit of white on my brush because those brighter colors tend to be very transparent and I want a softer blend, so making my paints a little bit more opaque is going to allow that. It's going to give me a little bit more of a it's not quite pastel because it's still pretty bright, but it's going to pastel it up a little bit. Now for blending, I'm using a fan brush, and the fan brush just helps you smooth colors together. I'm going in with some white because that white also helps blend the colors together because it, you know, will take away any streakiness that you might get from a transparent color, and just kind of helps everything flow together really well. You can take your time with this. It is acrylic, so it will dry quicker than oils, but you still have a little bit of time to work. I'm using a flat brush to paint in the stream, and I am taking my color cues from the sky. And by that I mean I'm looking directly above the stream to the sky and seeing what colors I see represented. The keys here is to get the colors reflected from the sky into the stream, and I also want to make sure I don't make any mud. So where we have a lot of the yellow there on the far left, I won't be getting that much yellow into the stream because the stream kind of wraps around over to the right side a little bit more. And I'm just right now blocking in the colors, and I'm putting them in kind of thickly so I'll be able to blend them together if I need to. And I am also hitting the edges of the canvas with the paint too, so I'll have that nice finished edge. Just keep filling in until you've got your stream all taken care of, and then we'll be able to do a little bit of kind of like ripples and things like that in a little bit, but we just need to get that kind of base coat down first. I know it can look really kind of coloring book at this stage, but it's all about building up the layers, I think, when you're working with acrylic paints, and you just got to be kind of patient with that process, but you want to get that all blended in. Then after you have those colors blended in, you can go in with some white using that same flat brush and horizontal strokes and just kind of get some like white ripples. So that's going to show that there's some movement in the water, and it's also going to lighten it up a little bit and make it look a lot more like water versus just some, you know, random colors that are in the foreground there. And don't worry if you go outside of your lines at all, because you're still going to be putting in some foliage, some grasses, things like that. So it doesn't have to be, like, the edges don't have to be perfect. It doesn't matter at all. Now I'm using a palette knife, and I am doing that so I can get some really interesting rough textures at the top of my mountain. I find that I get a much more natural looking mountain if I use a palette knife because you're able to kind of get those faces of the mountain that are kind of might be have rocks on them, might have trees, but it just looks almost kind of abstract and chunky at a distance, and that's what I'm doing here with a knife. Now, if you end up not liking it, you can always go in with a brush and smooth it out later. So it certainly doesn't hurt anything to try using that knife at the beginning. It also allows you to put down a good amount of paint, which will keep the paint wet long enough when using just a plain traditional acrylic like these inexpensive Royal and Langnickel acrylics. It allows you to put enough down that it's not going to dry so fast. So if you decide that you want a more blended look, you can go in with a brush and you can blend that out. You've got plenty of time to think about it and to do so. You can add shadows and valleys and other textures like that using some blue or some purple. Those cooler colors will actually push things further into the distance and make the mountains appear farther away. So that's another neat trick that you can do with your paint. I always wonder if paintings like this are boring or if they're interesting, so you can let me know in the comments below if you'd rather have something like this sped up, if that would be better for you, or if you like the real-time version. I'd love to know. Now, for areas where I feel like I want some more highlights or I want some more levels of texture, I'm going in with some yellow ochre and white mixed together. And I'm just basically kind of playing in the paint. It's really fun to do with the palette knife, and you have to be careful that you don't go overboard. So now I've grabbed a brush and I'm dragging some of that color down into the foreground, basically just filling up the white of the canvas because I know I'm going to have grasses there and I just want something down there to kind of be a point of reference. I'm not sure if I need this yellower yet, lighter yet, or what. So this just kind of gives me a little bit of a starting point. I'm adding some yellow highlights that could be like where the sun is rising, how it's kind of just spilling over the edge of the mountain, and I'm also doing that with some white. I'm just feeling like things would start to be getting a bit of a glow to them. Any of those ridges and plains that are kind of raised would get a little bit of glow. I'm also adding a little bit more white to the water. You can have a little touch of yellow in there too to get those early morning glistens on the water. And I'm also mixing some yellow into the foreground grasses because warm colors advance and cool colors recede, and I want those warmer foreground areas to come towards the viewer. I'm adding a little bit of a very, very pale sky blue to my palette, and I've picked up some white on a filbert brush, and I'm going to put in some clouds here. I want to have some nice puffy cumulus clouds kind of cascading across the right side of the canvas just to kind of bring some interest into the sky and just make it really just feel like a nice summery sunny day. Again, the oval wash or filbert brush is really nice for these techniques because it allows you to really control your paint. It's stiff enough to push it around, but you don't get those harsh brush strokes. Now I'm using that really light sky blue to put those breaks of blue sky in there. I was feeling that the purple felt a little too harsh, and just getting in that nice bright sky blue just helped the scene feel a little bit more bright, cheerful, and optimistic. And then I'm going ahead and adding some of that color into the water because it would be reflective. And I also feel like that gives me a little bit of more depth to my picture. I just feel like it pushes the horizon line further back and gives us a nice span of the sky and just makes it feel like it's like a big sky, I guess. Does that make sense? It just makes it feel like the painting goes back further and it kind of draws the eye through the painting a little bit more, I think. And a lot of those decisions that you're making like this happen to come from, you know, just your gut reaction as you're painting along. Like you're like, oh, I need that sky a little darker. Oh, I need it a little bit lighter. Oh, I need some clouds. I need some shape here. I need some pattern here. And things like clouds can add pattern and shape and direction to your painting. So you might not even realize that you're making these choices as you're painting, but you are. And sometimes it helps to actually, if you've ever like just set your phone even up, your smartphone, and recorded yourself painting, if you watched it back, you would probably see that, oh yeah, I guess I decided to do this here, do that there, and you'd have a greater insight to how you paint. Because I think once you've been painting for a long time, it feels more like instinct than a deliberate decision to add some movement. Like here, I'm adding a path to draw the viewer through the painting a little bit better. So I'm adding this kind of zigzag path. They get smaller as it tapers off, and it's got like one, two, three turns to the water. So that rule of thirds, it just kind of looks pleasant. And even though I might not be thinking about that as I'm painting it, like consciously, subconsciously, I am. I'm adding some of that golden color to the water because it would be appearing there from that right side of the sky where the stream is bending over to the right of the paper a little bit more. And that's also adding a little bit of repetition and harmony to the piece. There's so many little decisions that we make when we're doing a painting that we don't even realize. And if you're new to painting and you're watching a tutorial, you may not understand why is the artist doing that? Why is she putting that pink in there? Why does she have that shape in there? It may seem completely arbitrary, and then but then when you go try to paint it, if you haven't if you don't know why they put that in there and you decide to skip it, you might not realize why your painting looks so different or why it lacks movement or why it lacks some sort of quality from the tutorial you were going by. And it could just be you don't have the stream getting larger as it gets down towards the bottom of the paper, or it might be that you don't have the same amount of bends in your stream, or the same amount of turns in your stream, or the same highlights or whatever. So I think stuff like that helps, but oh, maybe a time lapse would be better. You can let me know in the comments below. And I'm just kind of puttering around at this stage. I was kind of like thinking, oh, I don't know about this. I don't know if this is going right or not. I was like, oh, I think I need some rocks or something. I don't have a lot of contrast here. I feel like I need something darker. So I started to put in some rocks using some. Oh gosh, I mixed a bunch of colors together. I think I have brown, blue, and a little bit of purple in there. And I just felt like I needed some more contrast, some more interest, because I felt like it was just kind of dull here, and I just wanted to break things up a little bit. It's funny, this painting reminded me of when I was little. I went to Sunday school for like a year, and there were always these posters in the Sunday school rooms, and they were like, that's what this reminds me of, the posters from the Sunday school rooms, like the really bright, idyllic colors and green pastures and that sort of thing. So it's kind of, and once I thought that, I couldn't unthink it. It's like that's all I could think of when I saw this painting. It's like, oh, it looks like the Good News Bible from when I was a little kid. But you can let me know what this reminds you of in the comments below. I'm adding some of that shadow color towards the water banks there. That could be, you could turn that into rocks. It could just be kind of, how you have like the dirt at the edge of the shore. Sometimes you get that kind of muddy dirt there. Or it could be rocks. Whatever you want to do is fine. Just what this is doing is giving you a little bit of contrast and detail. So when you have these details towards the bottom of your canvas, it's going to draw the eye in, and it's going to make the whole painting look more realistic just by putting details at the point that's closest to the viewer, which I decided to do with rocks here, close to the shore at the bottom of my page. So think of it this way: when you're looking at your canvas, the things that are closest to the bottom edge of your canvas and the top edge of your canvas are closer to you. The things that are closer to the middle of the canvas or the horizon line are furthest away from you. So if you think of that, keep that in your mind when you're painting and drawing landscapes. That's really going to help you get a lot more depth in your pictures so that you won't end up having everything really flat in a landscape. So I hope this has been helpful to you to watch this process. I'm adding a little bit more highlight here because we have all those clouds and there is some ripples in the water. Again, like I mentioned, you might end up painting something in and then painting it out and then putting it back in. I find when I'm doing acrylics and oils, I will tend to repaint things quite a few times that I don't with watercolor, and that could just be a proficiency thing. I paint with watercolor more, or maybe because watercolor is less forgiving. I know if I go back in, I'm gonna mess it up, so you're just best to leave it be. But with acrylics and oils, I do tend to fuss around and fiddle with the details a bit. Let me know if you're like that in the comments, or if you just kind of one and done. You put it down there, and that's where it stays. I guess when you get to this stage, it's kind of fun to be fussing around because you've got a lot of the you've got the bones of the painting in. Now you're just kind of decorating a little bit. And I think the decorating portion of a drawing or a painting is like the most fun part. And I guess that's probably why I tend to fuss around with this so much, because it's like I don't want this stage of the drawing to end, this is, or this stage of the painting to end, because it's so much fun. I'm really liking how it's coming along. I wasn't so sure when I was painting this. I'm voicing this over after the fact. And when I was first painting it, I was like, oh, I don't know. What have I done? This is awful. But then when you give yourself some time and you go back and look at it, a lot of times, most of the time, it looks a lot better. I'm not sure exactly what happens. I had an instructor tell me once that he goes, it's because you forget the battle. You forget how like frustrating it was at the time when you were painting it. So when you're looking at it in the future, all you see is the painting for what it is. You don't remember the battle or the struggle or whatever it was to get it to that point. And I thought, oh, you know what? You're probably right. And when students tell me they're frustrated with a painting, and I don't see anything wrong with a painting, I just say, put it away for a couple of days and then look at it, and you will probably be happy with it. Now, under these rocks, I am putting some shadows because they would cast a little shadow, especially in front of them since the light source is behind them. And I was just adding a little bit of a kind of like a bluish or a bluish purple color just to, helps kind of situate them in the water so it doesn't feel like they're hovering or floating above the water, and just gives it a nice grounding feeling, and also a nice visual weight to the bottom of this painting, which is really good because if you have this painting hanging on the wall, you want to have that visual weight, those heavier objects or heavier things down at the bottom of your canvas, just to give it just gives it a pleasant look. And you can go in and add any little highlights to any raised areas. You can add any of those golden, white, and yellow tones from the sunset, kind of cascading along any of the raised areas. I even went in and put a little bit of bright white right at the division between the skyline and the mountain, just to show that sun is just coming up. It's just peeking up above the horizon there, and just to kind of give it that glow, which is kind of idyllic, which is probably why I think it looks like a Sunday school painting. But in any event, it was really fun to paint. I hope you enjoyed it. We're just about done here. I'd say this painting probably took me closer to 45 minutes, but edited down kind of some of the repetitive stuff so it would be a little bit more interesting for you. And I'm just putting in a few little texturing details here just to give the mid-ground area a little bit of texture. So you got a little bit of kind of glowing grasses at the tips of the hills and whatnot. So I hope you give something like this a try. There are so many landscape photos you can find online, or you can make something up from your imagination, or you can go outside and paint on a nice day. That's always really good to do too. If you enjoyed this, please give me a thumbs up. I appreciate it. And until next time, happy crafting!